the overall diameter of the optic was 5, and then you can go ahead and put IOL inside. As far as calculations of the IOL is concerned, you really don't need to worry, because you just don't have to think that there is a lens inside. Do your normal calculation and put the lens that is necessary for that patient. Of course, you have to take in mind the astigmatism that your 5 mm wound would consider. I always take a stitch depending on the incision. I like to take incisions always in the steep axis, go behind the IOL and remove the viscoelastic. So this is as far as the ICLs are concerned. So in summary, whether it's LASIK or laser, a borderline case, prefer to do surface treatment. That's my protocol. If you do not do this, then of course you can do a bladeless, if that is possible, followed by SMILE, and otherwise a thin flap accelerated by cloth sinking if necessary. LASIK laser or ICL or clear lens extraction is better, that if they, as he said, mentioned that affordability nowadays of the ICL is quite easy, because quite a few of them can afford the Indian ICL. I think that I will end my this talk, and I'll start the next symposium immediately, because that's running into time. And the symposium is called Challenging the Challenge, the Most Difficult Cases in Cataract Surgery for 2020.
Thank you very much, Kumar. Thanks. And thank you all for joining us for this interesting symposium. And thank all the speakers for their contribution.
Thanks. So I'll start the symposium off on time. This is it. We have a good galaxy of speakers who will need absolutely no introduction. Actually, have you done this? A femto on a spherophakia. It's a big lens with very weak zonules. Okay, so we are trying to see this. So very shallow anterior chamber. Pupil dilates well. It's a small lens. Okay, so it's like a micro spherophakia, and you have to adjust the capsule size, etc. So this was one of the toughest cases that I have done. And you will see the difficulty that we find in different stages. So here I'm going ahead, adjusting the iris level, adjusting the CCC level, got my posterior. I'm now doing a 4.9 millimeter rexus. Okay. And you can see that this is the size of the rexus. And this is 4.9 millimeter. This is the sizing that it shows the size of the lens. And many times you will see that this is the diameter of the lens. So actually it's scanning beyond. There is nothing here. Okay. So you can see that the lens is ending here. This is the iris. This is the iris on the other side. So the zonules are pretty weak. Okay, so it's a micro spherophakia. You can see this space here. This space is actually there. And this means that the lens is ending there. And that's what is shown in this area. So we are still going ahead and doing the laser, then doing the CCC. After the CCC, the fragmentation. And now let's see the case clinically. So I got a nice CCC. That's 0.1. Okay. And you can see the edge of the lens here. Now the question is when to put the endocapsular ring. Now I prefer to put the endocapsular ring initially. Now when the lens is very, very small, to put the endocapsular ring is not all that easy. So you can see that I'm putting putting Helon GV just below the CCC and going till the equator. Once you go till the equator, you're creating the space. It's very, very important that we put the viscoelastic below the CCC, create the space, then put the endocapsular ring. So that will prevent the entrapment of the cortex that is going to happen. So once I've done that, it's a small lens. The smallest endocapsular ring is 10. Okay. So now we are going to go ahead, and it is a little struggle even to put an endocapsular ring inside. So you can see that it's gone in, going. And you can see the pull, and you can see the edge of the other ring. And now both the eyelets are overlapping each other. So at least now I got the bag in place, and now we go ahead and do phacoemulsification and remove the nucleus. So once that is done, the question was about the, you will notice that it's difficult to rotate, okay, in spite of doing hydro, and because the whole bag is shaking, you're a little scared. And then I'm able to manage to do phacoemulsification. Once the phacoemulsification is completed, I have to now go ahead and do a bimanual IA. So the whole bag shakes, as you know, because that is it. But I don't know whether we'll discuss this, whether it was better to anchor this bag or leave it as it is, because I don't know the long-term result. I've done this successfully. I'm doing bimanual IA. little bit of entrapment of cortex. This happened in one corner, but I could successfully remove the cortex from all the other corners. So as you can see, the bimanual eye is going on. There is a little bit of entrapment temporarily, otherwise it's all fine. So I got fed up of this cortex in this area. Then I went ahead and put a three-piece IOL, okay, in the bag. So I tried to remove the cortex from the other end and made sure that all of that is removed, and I left that little bit of cortex. Now the three-piece IOL goes into the bag, and that itself also stretches. So again, I'm able to put it in the bag quite well, and this will further hold the cortex. You can see the stretch on the zonules, and the lens is in the bag, and everything is going fine. And now I'm doing bimanual IA, and now removing the rest of the cortex that is possible. So this was like a spherophakia, did femto, put the lens in the bag. So Sri, what is your opinion on this? That is this bag going to hold on for a long time, young patient, or is it better to suture this bag, or is it better to remove the microspherophakia with doing a vitrectomy and then doing a glued IOL or something like that?
See, the zonules are not so weak. It's not like a necropia lentis, it's not progressive.
Yeah.
They are weak 360 degrees. So putting a CTR actually is just
supportive.
Yeah, supportive. But I would probably use hooks, capsular hooks, rather than a CTR, because they'll just hold the bag, and it's much easier to remove the cortex than putting a CTR.
Yeah.
So just putting the hooks, and then because the most difficult part is doing the capsulotomy.
Yeah.
Because the surface is very convex.
That I did through
so
the femto.
Because you did it with the femto, that is fine. But I would probably have put iris hooks.
Yeah.
Capsular hooks. Stabilize the bag. Turn the femto. Remove the cortex.
Yeah.
And then you can put in a
Now I'll show one more case, and I want to know what would you do here. Anybody from the audience would like to say something? You can see a persistent pupillary membrane, and there is a cataract behind. Patient is 22 years old. So what would you
what
do?
Is the corneal dia? You're measuring the corneal dia.
Yeah, so it's normal, 11.5.
Yeah, you can go ahead and then basically you need to kind of, you can remove the persistent pupillary membrane with a vitrector.
Yes.
And then the pupil will expand, or you can stretch it and put in a Mulligan ring or any form of support or iris hooks, and then go ahead with the removing the cataract.
We are now measuring the corneal diameter here. Okay, putting a viscoelastic, making two nicks, and now, as mentioned, going around and cutting it, okay? And you can see the cataract. Now, what a difference was that I had got a UBM done for this patient, and the UBM showed subluxation in a large o-clock position. So that was a little different. So we got a UBM done, and we rechecked during the procedure. Now see the checking that I'm doing. So complete inferior to nasal means one side from here, this o-clock, till here, there were no zonules, okay? So there is a cataract, no doubt about it. So now the whole strategy changes, and there are some iris growth. This process is from the pigmentation that is on the back surface of the lens that you can see here, this area. The brown pigmentation that is there has gone there. And there is some iris growth happening at that level. So now I'm going ahead, and I shifted the patient to femto, okay? Then I did rexis and fragmentation. So you can see the lower surface of the posterior surface of the lens. Okay? And I shifted the patient to femto, got the anterior surface in, did the CCC. And once the CCC was done, of course it was a small CCC. I would have preferred it to a large. As you can see, it's a 2.9 millimeter CCC. Young patient, so I didn't expect a hard cataract inside. Did a little bit of fragmentation. Let's see how it behaved clinically.
Not much of tilt on the OCT.
Yeah, yeah.
There's not much of a tilt.
Yeah, but there was no zonules. On UBM, there were absent zonules. And you will see that whole area does not have zonules at all. So I thought it was a partially kind of absorbed whole lens. So I did a CCC, then enlarged that CCC, and then did side ports. And as you said, I now give additional support with capsular hooks in the area of subluxation. Now, I'm not doing any phaco here because it's a young patient, a 22-year-old, and just going ahead and doing a bimanual IA. So you can see that I've done a bimanual IA. And And of course the glow is not what you would want it to be. And now I'm going ahead and doing a Sionis with a pocket. But now I think I would not do a Sioni. I've learned the dumbbell technique, and I would fix a Sioni with a dumbbell.
TDS is better. The problem is, maneuvering the Sioni, because it's attached to the ring, the eyelet.
Yeah.
So maneuvering the eyelet into position, it puts more stress on the zonules.
Yeah.
So CTS, you put a CTR,
yes,
and a CTS, that is much better than using the Sioni.
Yeah. But I'm used to this. So here I've done a Sionis, and then the railroad technique, and then tightening it, the other needle, and then removing it out through the Hoffman's pocket, and then tying it. So that part is looked after. The lens in the back. So, it did a femtorexis, did IA, removed the cataract, supported the bag, and put the IOL. So this I thought was one of the other tough cases that we have done this year. If you want to see the post-op video, you can see a bit of capsular phimosis in this area. Otherwise the pupil becomes nice and small. This was a dilated video taken post-op.